welcome each and every one of you. We're glad you're here. Let's stand all over the building. Can I ask Brother Evangelist John Morgan, if you will, make his way up here, Brother John. Going to begin with prayer. Remain standing. We'll sing a couple good congregational hymns of the faith. We are delighted and we are honored, all right? Delighted and honored that you were here tonight for the Old Pass Youth Rally here at Mountain View Baptist Church, all right? Once again, the balcony's filling up, but if you want a postered pew, you come down here and you're more than welcome. Brother John, if you'll pray with us, please. All right,
Pastor, let's pray. Father, we bow in your wonderful presence tonight. Lord, we want to thank you for Calvary and the blood and the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for the resurrected Savior. Thank you for the hope of glory. Lord, you said in everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Lord, I want to do the will of God tonight and just simply say thank you for all that you've done for me, all that you've done for us. Thank you for this place. Thank you for these people. Thank you, Lord, most of all, for your precious presence, how you've been good to us. Lord, we just can't thank you enough, just can't praise you enough. Thank God, we just can't tell you how much you mean to us tonight. Lord, I pray we'd say thank you long enough to at least hear you say you're welcome tonight. And Father, we bow in your presence. Lord, there's a lot of young people here tonight. Lord, you know every heart. You know every rebellious heart, every backslid heart. Lord, you know every young person's got a wall built up between you and them. Lord, I pray tonight, God, you'd tear the walls down, melt the ice off their hearts. Lord, I pray you'd break into their lives tonight. God, that you'd give their attention and get a hold of them. Lord, I pray you'd do for them what you did for us about 25 years ago. And Lord, I pray and send an old time Holy Ghost heaven sent, send Kevin revival. Lord, you'd stir this generation up. I pray you'd call these young men to preach. Fill them with the Holy Ghost of God. Father, I pray you bless the singing tonight and touch that. Lord, I pray most of all you bless a man of God. Fill him with the Spirit of God. I pray, Lord, you'd flow through it. Touch him, Lord, anoint him. Give him liberty. Lord, to preach the word of God. I pray that the grace of God would be strengthened, settled, and establish his heart tonight. Help him to know the mind of God. Help him to run well and to preach, to exalt Christ. I pray when we leave here, Lord, we'll know we've been in a Christ-exalting meeting. Help us, Lord. We'll bless you and praise you. Lord, we don't demand your command. We cast ourselves at your feet, begging for mercy. Lord, if you don't do it, it ain't going to get done. And we'll bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, we're going to sing one out of the Red Book. You may have a copy. If not, sing along. I know my name is there.
I know, I know, I know.
All of our youth choir. Come on, youth choir. Somebody, you love them in Jesus' name. Our youth choir's coming. Come on, come forward. Everybody, shake somebody's hand. Everybody. Psalmist said in Psalm 122, verse 1, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go unto the house of the Lord. Now, you know why I love that verse, Brother Doug? He hadn't even got there. He said, I was just glad when somebody talked about it. And I can go to the house of the Lord. I hope you feel that way tonight. We definitely do. We are honored that you're here. We thank you for being here. I'll recognize some folks in a little bit. But just thank you, every one of you. We'll get our preachers in a little while, but we're just going to move the service on and let the youth choir do about four. Then we're going to have the Range family come to sing. But if you're a visitor, just know, please, tonight that you're the honored guest here at Mountain View Baptist Church. And we're delighted that you're participating in this youth rally, all right?
Thank you. They say times are changing, so we should change too. Trade our old-time religion for something new. Our faith is outdated while living the past. Well, my answer is simple, so if you ask.
I see the need of
stay on the old path that's brought us this far. It saved countless millions and reached heart and heart. Although times are changing, forever will. There'll still be one Savior, one
hear the hall.
Jesus saves.
want to say thank you to all of our young people and young adults that participated and helped out in the youth choir singing tonight. And it's a blessing to be able to have all the little boys and girls and teenagers here in church. And listen, we give God all the glory. We really do. We give him all the glory that we've got just a slew of a bunch of little youngins running around. And we thank God for it, all right? We're moving right on with the service, and I will take some time at the end. I want to recognize some folks, but we're also, brother, let me get my name pad here. Brother Mark Wheeler, are you, Brother Mark Wheeler, is that you right back here? Didn't you write a song, and you could sing it for us in a little bit, maybe after them? If you'd kind of come up here and get ready while they're going to do about three. And I want to preface this family here by saying that I've known them for a very, very, very long time. And I have as much confidence in the people standing behind me as any Christian family in the United States of America. And I love them, and I appreciate them. This is Brother Doug Raines, his family. Of course, Miss Natalie's married to her husband, but so they're all joined up. This is Adam, he's on the base now, but we're delighted they can be with us. I want you to worship the Lord and be blessed with their singing, all right?
It's good to be in the Lord's house, and thank God for all those choir songs. And I've been a choir leader, so I reckon Cam's worried about still, but I'm glad they sang it. And I told Brother Steve when it had a little snag there, I said that gave the rest of us hope. So don't worry about it. It is a blessing. Here's what I wanted to say. First time I ever came here, I was an 8-year-old boy. This building wasn't here. I whizzed across the street. And I've told y'all that before, but I've got old enough to where I can tell the same story twice if I want to. First time I came, I was 8 years old. And service felt about like this one. And now I've got grandbabies here at Mountain View. God's been really good to me. I've got friends, I've got cousins whose lives are absolute nightmares. I've got family members like you, but I'm no better than them, but I'm better off. And I just want you to know that God's been really good to me. And I don't know what the preacher's going to preach tonight, but it's going to be truth. And if you came here tonight needing help, I'd beg you to get it before you leave. Because this is the only life worth living. I love him. He's been good to me.
Still dark.
I stand here and think about just what he's done. I start counting my blessings one by one. I do not deserve all that he's done for me, but I'll praise him forever through eternity. I am amazed that he takes the time to give me such blessings that fill up my life. He is so good, I cannot express how thankful I am. I am so blessed. He's given me breath and he's given me life. He saved my lost soul from torment and strife. Christ died on the cross just to show me his love, and he's building my hope in heaven above. I am amazed that he takes the time to give me such blessings that fill up my life. He is so good, I cannot express how thankful I am. I am so blessed.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
Often I stumble as I journey this way,
but his mercies are new every day.
His grace is sufficient for every trial.
Christ my Lord, over Satan I win. I am amazed that he take the time to give me such blessings that fill up my life. He is so good, I cannot express how thankful I am. I am amazed that he takes the time to give me such blessings that fill up my life. He is so good, I cannot express how thankful I am.
We probably could take recess, just dismiss, run out in the parking lot. I'm serious about it. Shout all night, amen. God's been good to this outfit. God sure has been good to us. While our brother's getting mic'd up, this is Brother Mark Willery. I believe he's with the Marksman Quartet or group and been singing for years. And I think he wrote this song. But just before he sings, because I get in a lot of hurry, but I want to recognize some very special guests tonight, and they've driven all the way from Anderson, South Carolina, and it literally took them 2 hours plus tonight because of the terrible traffic in Greenville. And I want them to stand. They're with the Haven of Rest Ministries right here on my left. Gentlemen, we are thrilled that you're here. God bless you. And Brother Bruce, Pastor Bruce Wyatt, dear friend, and brought you men, you're always welcome. God bless you. I think the farthest group, I want the group from Denham Street Baptist Church in Somerset, Kentucky. Can you believe that? 4.5 hours. 4.5 hours. God bless y'all. Appreciate it. Their pastor is my brother, and he's in a meeting, but we'll get some more groups in a minute. Well, we got Miss Fleur. Miss Fleur, would you stand? All right. Your family. I don't know if you drove all the way from Florida, but we're glad you're here. And by the way, tell your husband we really, really love him. Amen. So God bless you, Miss Fleur. And I think I got that Fleur. I never get it right. All right. Come on, sing. All right. Preach. Sing for us. Amen. We're going to have the preacher.
Amen. Well, I drove 4.5 hours, but I just come from Georgia. Up 85. Amen. It's good to be here tonight. I always wanted to say this. I didn't come to sing. I've not always been faithful, but he has. I've not always been graceful, but he has. I've not always been true, oh, but he's always come through. Tell him I'm not strong, and he says, I am. I say I can't go on, he says I can. And I've not loved everyone, and I've not always overcome. Oh, but he has, yes, he has. Been the greatest friend this world has ever known. He has paid the debt on Calvary all alone. He has given me a melody and song. He has. Yes, he has. I can't see what's ahead, but he has. I can't conquer death, oh, but he has. When tempted to sin. Well, I may fail the test again. Oh, but he passed. Yes, he has. He has. Never known. He has. Paid the debt on Calvary all alone. He has given me a melody and song. He has. Yes, he has. He has. He always. The greatest friend this world has ever known. He has paid the debt on Calvary all alone. He has given me a melody and song. He has. Yes, he has. Oh, he has. Yes, he has.
CDs. I want a CD of that. What for? So when I'm all by myself and feeling really, really low, put that baby in the CD player, go down the road, let the Holy Ghost get in the car with me. If you've never had the Holy Ghost get in the car with you, you don't know what you're missing. Just have a time, amen. I mean, just have a time. Isn't God good? Thank God. Real quick, before he comes, all of our preachers, I'm going to do this real quick. If you're a God-called preacher or you're the youth leader of your group, would you stand all over the building, all right? All the preachers, all right? Now, you know there's no women, all right? We know that. If you're a woman, we're going to throw you right out there in that parking lot. And you're not going to get no pizza either. All right, let's do it. Let's do it quick. Listen, man, thank you for coming. It means so much to us. Let's start. I want you good and loud. I want to hear who all these people are. Right here, brother. Burnsville, North Carolina. Go right ahead. God bless you. God bless you. Welcome. Okay, great. Yes, sir. Right here in Cowpens, brother. God bless you. Walterboro, South Carolina. Long trip. Long trip. Thank you. Go right ahead. Wow, man. How far is Walterboro from here? 3 hours, bless your heart. Well, them guys on the front row, they'll give you some gas money, all right? Go right ahead, son. God bless your heart. God bless you, Brother John, right here on the front. God bless you, Brother Austin, preacher.
Justin Cooper from North Valley Baptist Church, Santa Clara, California.
He came the farthest. He came from California. You got that? California, yay. That's where he hails from now, all right? Pastor? God bless you, brother. God bless you, Brother Shane. God bless you. God. Kentucky, all right, right here in the middle. Way up in the mountains, y'all. Go ahead. God bless your heart, right here. And Statesville is how far, brother? Statesville from here? An hour and a half? Hour? God bless you. So glad you made the trip. Yes, sir. Brother Dan, right in the back. Gaffney, God bless you. Right here in the middle. God bless your heart right here. Gateway, appreciate it. God bless you, Brother Robbie. Yes, sir. Brother John. God bless you, Brother Bruce. God bless your heart, Brother Bruce. Right on the far left. Dawsonville, Georgia. How far is that? God bless your heart. Man, don't you appreciate these people driving this far? We got folks live 5 minutes from here, ain't here. God, go right ahead. Wahoo, God bless you. In the balcony. Yes, sir, Brother Shields. Yes, sir, Brother Shields. God bless you. So glad you got a big group here. We appreciate it right here on the front. God bless your heart. Right here, way in the back, God, good and loud.
Amen.
All right. God bless you. God bless your heart. Appreciate every one of you preachers. Now, is there a youth leader that maybe your preacher's not here, but we didn't recognize your group from wherever you're? Is there a youth leader that would stand and tell us what group you are and where you're from real quick before the preacher comes? A youth leader or a youth pastor? Or a man of the church? Could we get a woman to do it? Come on, preacher. Come on. Come on, preacher. This dear man recently moved to, I think it's San Jose, California. It's evangelist Justin Cooper. But out there where he's at now, he's also known as Pastor Cooper. So the Lord's got everything under control in his life. We're honored. We are absolutely honored to have this precious man of God. And we're going to give him all the time he wants. The food will be there when we get there. Preacher, the pulpit's yours.
All right, take your Bible, please. Turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 26 this evening. 2 Chronicles chapter number 26. It's my honor to be with you tonight, and I am privileged to be here, preacher. Thank you for the invitation. I've been praying for this meeting ever since they called and asked me to come. And I've been sitting there on the front row or second row thinking, man, how can I don't know. I'm going to have to buy a house over here. I don't know how I'm going to do that. I don't make enough money to, because y'all take me on for support. But anyway, if just like 1 week out of the month, I could just come here and sit, you know, just listen. That'd help me. Probably if I was going to put together like who I wanted to sing before I preached, I'd probably put that line up together that sang tonight. The youth choir and the Raines family and Brother Wheeler. If only we had Brother Bill Monroe, it'd been perfect, you know. But now I'm looking forward to what God's going to do tonight. I don't know what God's going to do, but I know this. God wants to do something. I just believe God's still working. I believe God's still where he's ever been. I think God's still interested in this generation. And I'm praying God to get a hold of somebody's heart. I prayed all the way through the night last night flying here. And then I definitely prayed when Brother Landon picked me up. And praying about tomorrow morning right now while I'm thinking about it. But anyway, I'm honored you're here. Thank you, preachers, for taking time to come. Many of you I know, and it's good to see you again. It's almost like feel like a homecoming, you know, get to see folks you haven't seen in a while. If you're able to stand with me, 2 Chronicles chapter number 26, we're going to read verse 1, going through verse number 6, and we'll give you the thought God laid on my heart this evening. I don't have 3 points or 4 points or anything. I just got something on my heart, and I'm praying God will use it to speak to us tonight. 2 Chronicles chapter 26, verse number 1. The Bible said, then all the people of Judah took Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in the room of his father Amaziah. He built Eloth and restored it to Judah after that the king slept with his fathers. 16 years old was Uzziah when he began to reign, and he reigned 52 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name also was Jechaliah of Jerusalem. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father Amaziah did. And he sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God. And as long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. Now we'll talk in just a few minutes. At the end of Uzziah's life, he'll mess up. He ends wrong, but thank God he started well. And the Bible says that under this young man, a 16-year-old king, the nation prospered. They were blessed. The hand of God was evident, because of the actions of this young man by the name of Uzziah. It doesn't say Uzziah was a great marketer or an expert at social media posts. Hello, everybody all right? The key to the prospering of his nation was this young man, the Bible said, he sought God. The Bible said as long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. I'm convinced that as you read and study history, you see the hand of God on our nation, on generations, because those generations, our nation has had men and had women who had a hunger, not for things of this world, but had a hunger for God. And I believe God blessed and God sent awakenings and God sent revival because he had one, at least, that sought him. For a little while this evening, I'll be honest with you, I came all the way here for one purpose. I want to enlist somebody. Well, I'd like to have a draft tonight. I mean, just put a sign-up sheet on the altar and pray that at least one person step out and write their name on a contract and give their life to God. And I want to preach on this thought this evening. We need a seeker for the sake of our generation. We need a seeker for the sake of our generation. Some of you young men need to understand there's something bigger than video games and balls. There's something bigger than just making money, punching a time clock, and riding the pine till Jesus comes. Somebody needs to step out beyond normal, beyond the expected, and do something for God. Let's pray and we'll get into thought. Lord, I pray for your power, please. I pray you'd fill me with the Holy Spirit of God just now. And God, I pray you'd speak to the heart of every young man, every young lady this evening. God, give us someone who'll hunger and thirst after righteousness is my prayer. God, I need you. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. You can be seated. In 1872 in London, I read there was a woman by the name of Marianne Adler. Marianne Adler was a shut-in, just a young lady, but she was too sick to ever attend her church. But she laid in bed, and every day she prayed that God might send revival to her church. She couldn't sit in the pew, but she could pray. She couldn't attend the service, but she could seek God. She couldn't go there, but she could go to the throne on behalf of those that could go there. And she prayed and asked God to meet with them and send revival. One day she got a paper that was given to her, and the title of that paper, the publication, was just called Revival. And in that paper, there was a man that was the name by the name of D.L. Moody, and they were talking about D.L. Moody and the meetings he had in America. Now, she was there in Europe, and she began to pray that God would send that man by the name of D.L. Moody to her church in her town that they might see revival. It just happened that D.L. Moody got a break in his schedule, and just so happened that it got put on his heart to take a vacation, and it just so happened that he'd take a vacation in her city. It just so happened that he'd be in her city and feel led to go to her church. Just so happened that way. He sat in a pew on a Sunday morning, and as he sat there, the preacher saw that man, D.L. Moody, sitting in the pew, and the preacher just so happened to feel led to have D.L. Moody come and preach in her church. D.L. Moody got up from the pulpit and said, I didn't plan to preach. I didn't come here to preach. And God gave him a message, and as he began to preach, folks fell under conviction, and over 100 people got saved in her church that day. He preached there for several weeks. The meeting continued. Over 400 people were added to that church. D.L. Moody said, I'd never seen a move of God like that before. And he said, it interests me what happened there. He said, I asked the preacher. Preacher didn't know. I asked the people. He said, we didn't really prepare for it. He said, I began to inquire and go around the city till my inquiries took me to the house of a young lady by the name of Marianne Adler. She'd been laying in her bed seeking God to send revival. And he said, little did I know that that woman seeking God brought me to that church and God brought revival to those people. There's a poem, and I'm not big on poetry, but I'll read it to you. It says, I met God in the morning when my day was at its best, and his presence came like sunrise, like a glory in my breast. All day long the presence lingered. All day long he stayed with me, and we sailed in perfect calmness o'er a very troubled sea. Other ships were blown and battered. Other ships were sore distressed, but the winds that seemed to drive them brought to us a peace and rest. Then I thought of other mornings with a keen remorse of mind when I too had loosed the moorings with that presence left behind. So I think I know the secret learned from many a troubled way. You must seek him in the morning if you want him through the day. I want to go on record tonight and say I'm eternally grateful that God sought me. Like Saul of Tarsus, I was wicked and God sought me. Like the maniac of Gadara, I was in bondage, but God sought me. Like Lazarus, I was dead, but thank God he sought me. And I'm glad this evening our God is a seeker. I'm glad that when I wasn't looking for him, thank God he was looking for me. When I didn't have him on my mind, I'm glad I was on his heart. When I didn't know who he was, I'm glad he knew me better than I knew myself. And I'm glad even when lost and undone, there was a God in heaven who was looking for me, and he wanted me, and he longed for me, and he came seeking after me. Like the hymn says, Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. God the Father created man and sought fellowship with man. God the Son died for sinners and sought fellowship with sinners. The Holy Ghost now resides within us, and he seeks to fellowship with you and I. I'm glad our God's a seeker. I'm glad our Savior's a seeker. I'm glad the Holy Ghost is a seeker. And I'm just convinced tonight that our God smiles on, our God loves on, our God blesses those that follow his example and will diligently seek after God. In Hebrews 11, verse 6, the Bible says, but without faith it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. In Hebrews 11, we read about all the heroes of the faith. But I'll say we wouldn't have a hero of the faith to read about had there not been some men and some women that followed the principle of verse number 6 and gave their heart to hunger and seek diligently after God. Noah was a seeker. Abraham was a seeker. Enoch was a seeker. Colossians 3:1 says, if ye have been risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. And in this era of Christians that are wrapped up with seeking money, and wrapped up with seeking celebrity, and wrapped up with seeking comfort, and wrapped up with things of earth, I say it's time we get another Marianne Adler. It's time we got another Abraham. It's time that we had another Noah. It's time we had another Enoch. It's time we had a man, had a woman, had a young man, a young lady that get serious and step out and get hungry and seek after God for the sake of our generation. Pride is a poisonous thing in the life of a Christian. Pride can take the most sincere motives and bankrupt those motives. Sadly, when we think about the reign of King Uzziah, the end of his life is a testimony of just how terrible pride can be. We find a man who is blessed become broken because of pride. We find a king who is righteous fall into sin because of pride. We find a boy who sought God grow up to be a man who overstepped God all because of pride. He should have left a legacy of the hand of God and the goodness of God, but instead his life is a legacy of the judgment of God because of pride. Uzziah is a lesson to you and I that whenever that flame of pride begins to flicker in our heart, you'd be wise to quickly snuff it out and quench any flame of pride that burns. Can I say you and I are anything? If anything good comes out of us, it's not because we're good. It's not because we deserve it. It's not because we're worthy. It's because he's good. He's worthy. It's because he deserves it. Hey, I tell you how you get God to use your life. You realize you're nothing and he's everything. And if God chooses to use you, hey, praise God for it. But it's not because of our pedigree. It's not because of our resume. Hey, we got to be quick to quench that flame of pride that flickers in our life. The Bible said in verse 16 that when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to destruction. You see, here's what happened. He was blessed, and Uzziah let his blessings make him backslide. Can I say it's a bad day when you start to love your blessing more than the blesser, and you forget where that good thing came from? Can I say every breath you breathe, every bit of food on the table, the shoes you're wearing tonight, every bit of health you enjoyed, hey, you didn't do that. You didn't merit that. That's the goodness of God and the grace of God. And we better be careful in America that we don't let our blessings help make us backslide and stray and get away from the Lord. One day Uzziah approaches the altar of God. Now, Uzziah had rights to the throne. He didn't have any rights to the altar. He was a king, but he wasn't a priest. Uzziah was swelled up like a rooster. He goes strutting up to the throne. He's going to burn incense, he thinks. He's going to step into an area that wasn't his. By the way, you'd be wise to mind your own business, hello, and stay in your own lane and just fill your own role. Say amen right there. He walks up to the, everybody all right? He walks up to that throne, and as soon as he begins to burn incense, the priest interrupts. Azariah says, wait a minute, king. He said, that doesn't pertain to you. He said, you have rights to that throne, but not to that altar. The king should have responded differently. Can I say, what will make or break tonight is how you choose to respond to the voice of God. He swells up with pride. He reaches his hand toward that altar, and immediately the Bible says that leprosy began to rise up in his forehead. And the rest of that man's life, he lives separated from God in a several house, and he dies a leper, not buried with the kings, but close to where they're buried, all because of pride. But I'm glad he didn't start out that way. Now, thank God for those who start right, but I wish you'd finish well too. But Uzziah didn't begin a failure. He wasn't always poisoned by pride. He began well, and God blessed him in a wonderful way. In fact, there's a statement made about young Uzziah that God used to hit me right in the heart as I was reading this chapter. And I'm praying tonight it would hit you in the heart as well, because there's some things in the Bible that you and I cannot do. I cannot walk on water, and I can't open blinded eyes, and I can't raise the dead. If I could, I'd do it about every Sunday. Hey, I can't do everything that we see done in the Bible. But this thing right here, hey, if I want to, if I have a hunger to, I can do this thing right here. You see, Uzziah took the throne early in life. Can you imagine the weight that was put on his shoulders? I mean, all the responsibility, all the day-to-day policies, running a kingdom of that size. This is a young man. I mean, he's only 16 years old. He wasn't even old enough to join the military in our day, barely old enough to drive a car. He isn't old enough to vote if he'd been living in 2019. And now the responsibility of the kingdom is placed upon him. This 16-year-old young man becomes a builder, a battler, and a preserver of righteousness in his nation. Now let me call time out and give just a public service announcement. I tell you what, it kind of bothers me that as a 16-year-old young man, he had that kind of character and could handle that kind of responsibility. And we got a breed of young men today. I mean, they don't know how to change the oil in a car. They can't load a shotgun. They can't skin a squirrel. They think a weed eater's a vegetarian. They knew more about essential oils than changing the oil in their car. Say amen right there. I mean, they don't ever get dirty. They don't ever grunt or sweat. They can ask permission from their mama or their girlfriend to say amen in church. Hey, can I say something? We need a revival of manhood. We got these preachers today. They walk to the pulpit. Looks like they got dressed in the little girl section of Baby Gap. Amen. They come up to the pulpit, skinny jeans. I mean, this perpetual adolescence in America. Can I say our nation might get turned back to God if some men would realize, hey, that's what you are. God didn't make an accident. God didn't create you by mistake. If you're a man, you gotta act like a man, be a man, get off the video games, get in your Bible, take a stand for God. 16 years old and already making a difference. Think about it. 16 years old, he didn't have much experience. 16 years old, he didn't have much training. 16 years old, he never even led a family. The odds are stacked against him. The weight is a great weight that's on his shoulders, but the Bible says this young man prospered. In spite of his shortcomings, he prospered. In spite of the odds, he prospered. In spite of his age, he prospered. In spite of his generation, he prospered. The nation was strengthened under that young man. The enemies were subdued under that young man. His people were blessed under that young man. The families were benefited under that young man. There was revival taking place under that young man. He wasn't a mighty man of war. He wasn't a great prophet. He wasn't some old wise sage. Just a young man. But the Bible says his nation prospered. Can I say I believe God could do the same thing in America if we could get a younger generation, hey, that gets serious about doing what Uzziah did. I tell you, we don't have to have a crowd, but if I could get one or two tonight to say I want to be Uzziah for the sake of my generation, I think we can still see God do something in our land. Now, I believe the key to the blessings that Uzziah saw early in his life, I mean, the key to his resume is found in verse number 5. The Bible says in verse number 5, and he sought God. Can I say that sounds out of character for a teenager? That doesn't sound like a young man to me. He wouldn't have fit in with the rest of his youth group. He was serious about one thing. He's wrapped up in one thing. He's all about one thing. You say, Uzziah, what do you got planned today? What's on your schedule? What do you want to do? Here's what he'd say. I think today I'll seek God. I think about noontime I'll seek God. I think this evening I'll seek God. He understood something. He understood I'm young. I don't have the understanding to rule, so I'll seek the one who knows it all. I'm young. I don't have the strength to rule, so I'll seek the one who has all power. I'm young. I don't have the ability to rule, so I'll seek the one who's from everlasting to everlasting God. And he took the throne. He didn't seek power. He didn't seek popularity. He didn't seek retweets. Hello? He sought after God. By the way, the Bible says he sought the same God that his daddy sought. He sought the same God the former generation sought. He didn't seek a new God. He didn't seek a different God. He didn't seek a modern God. He didn't seek a God that fit his day. He sought the same God that brought blessings in the past, the same God that smiled on him before, the same God that his daddy fallen. And can I say, if it was good for our fathers, that'd be good enough for us. If preaching worked, it worked. If the King James Bible worked, it works. If soul winning works, it works. If separation worked, it'll work. If the hymns worked, it'll work. I'm not looking for a new path. I'm not looking for a new way. I'm not looking for a new road. I don't want a new angle. I'm just trying to walk in the path that's been laid out for us by the former generation. I tell you what helps some of y'all is to get them, I haven't even been here before. Maybe get some of these Southern Baptist preachers off of your social media. Hello? And then go find you some old CDs or tapes of Percy Ray and Billy Kelly and Mays Jackson and men like that, Oliver B. Green, and get plugged into that. I'm not seeking something different. I want the same thing and more of it. I'd say the tendency of a young man in a big position would be to seek prestige. Seek fame and fortune. But he understood, if I'm going to be successful, if we're going to see anything good happen, I'm going to have to get serious about seeking God. He desired God's counsel. He wanted God's power. He wanted God's protection. So he sought the Lord. Now let me try to apply it tonight. We live in a nation that's in desperate need. And the kind of need our nation's in is not the kind of need that can be met by the school system or political pundits. It's not the kind of need that'll be met by some kind of vaccine created in a laboratory somewhere. But our nation's in need of an awakening again. Our nation's in need of a sweeping move of God. I tell you, there's some of us that have been a privilege to spend and be spent traveling this country, preaching to groups like this, and I don't do it just for fun, and I don't do it because it's a hobby, and I don't do it because I don't have anything else to do. I tell you, I long to see God move in my day like I read about God moving in former days. These are desperate times, perversity on every hand, morality being attacked, normal is now called abnormal, abortion being applauded by politicians. They're trying to impeach our president. They're not mad at him. They're mad at any kind of authority that leans to the right. They're mad at God. That's who they're after. But can I say, we live in a nation where they don't even know what bathroom to use. And it's one thing to bury our head in a spiritual bomb shelter and try to hide till the rapture. It's one thing to be willingly ignorant and put your head in the sand. But can I say, I want to make a difference. I want to do something for God. I want to punch a hole in the darkness. Our college campuses are rearing up activists instead of scholars. They're indoctrinating people in their kind of pervert theology. Can I say, it's not time, though, to slack. It's not time to hunker down. It's not time to back up. It's not time to blush. I believe it's time for a young man, maybe an older man. It's time for a lady, a young lady, to get a hold of this thing. Get a hunger in your heart. Say, I'll be a Uzziah and seek God for our generation. For the sake of those on their way to hell, I wonder, would you seek God for the sake of those that are hurting and broken? Would you seek God for the sake of those in bondage to sin? Would you seek God, for the sake of those indoctrinated by the LGBTQ movement? Would you seek God for the sake of those who are discouraged tonight? Would you seek after God for the sake of your church, for your city, for your state, for your nation, for your generation? Would you seek after God? I'm not looking for the next big name preacher. We got enough of those. I'm not looking for the next entertainer. We got enough of those. I'm not after the next athlete. We got enough of those. I'm not looking for the next so-and-so. That list is long and lengthy. That line is out the door. But that won't be what makes a difference in our generation. We need a young man who learns what the prayer clause is all about. We need a young lady who understands what it is to walk with God. We need some young people who find themselves on a mountain, in a pea patch, in a private place, and get that touch on their life like the former generation had on their life. I'm afraid we pray seeking answers, but we ought to pray seeking God. We go to church wanting to be entertained, but we ought to go wanting God. We serve trying to find results, but we ought to serve seeking God. We try to win souls seeking souls. You ought to win souls seeking God. We try to stay clean to seek power. You ought to stay clean seeking God. We sing to seek applause. You ought to sing seeking God. We preach to seek an amen. You ought to preach seeking God. Paul said, for all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. And there's a crowd that seeks fame. And there's a crowd that seeks fortune. And there's a crowd that seeks followers. They want approval from the world. I don't want to be in that crowd. I decided to go another way. And I'm looking for someone to sign up tonight, someone to enlist tonight. Would you do it? Would you put your name on the line and say, I'll be a seeker for the sake of my generation? Noah wasn't seeking to build a big boat. He was seeking God and got to build the boat. David wasn't seeking to kill the giant. He was seeking God and got to kill the giant. Shadrach and those other boys weren't seeking to walk through the fire. They were seeking God, and God led them through the fire. Peter didn't seek to preach Pentecost. He was seeking God and got voted in to preach Pentecost. Paul didn't seek to preach sermons and pen the scripture. He sought God, and God let him preach and pen the scripture. Can I say that's who God uses? We got too many folks seeking status and seeking some kind of a title and seeking position. Can I say God is better than status? God is better than title? God is better than position? He's sweeter than the honey and the honeycomb. And there's some things I can't do. I can't walk on water. I can't heal the sick. I can't raise the dead. But by the help of God, I can seek him like a man looking for bread, like a woman thirsty for water, like a deer panting after the brook, like a baby wants milk, like a grown adult wants the meat. I can get hungry for God in my life. I remember when I first surrendered to preach, I was 22 years old. You say, how old are you now? I said, you're stinking business. Hello. I was in Rock Hill, South Carolina. I lived there for a long time, so that's why I'm allowed to preach here. But anyway, my wife and I were married, just got married in July. I was teaching in a Christian school in Charlotte, and it was going a little bit left, and I was in church on a Sunday morning, another church, and God called me to preach. I didn't have enough sense back then to understand. You probably don't want to quit your job till you got one. But I'd rather have to calm someone down than try to work them up. Hello. So I quit my job, and we lost that house and new cars and things, and we moved into Rock Hill, and this little double-wide trailer had skylights in the ceiling that weren't supposed to be there. There was a hole on the wall on one side, and I looked in there and said, there's something in that wall, and my wife took a pair of grill tongs, stuck it in there, pulled out a petrified biscuit out of the wall. I'm talking about it should have been on HGTV, right? So he said, what's that stand for? Hell's Got Television. But anyway, my wife isn't here, so I'm going to preach tonight. I didn't have any meetings. I didn't know anybody. Didn't go to any kind of Bible college. My dad's not a preacher. I didn't get saved till I was 21. I remember in the back bedroom of that little double-wide trailer, red carpet like this, but covered in cigarette burns and things from the previous people who rented it. I remember getting on my face and that blue tarp on the ceiling, you could see sunlight coming through it, begging God that he'd give me a meeting, one meeting somewhere. And getting back here and reading my Bible. Nobody making me read my Bible, by the way. I didn't have a checkoff list. Nobody making me dress right. Nobody making me pray. Man, I just wanted God so much. I'd read about these meetings from the past, and I got to rub elbows with some older preachers that tell me about different meetings they'd been to. And I just started thinking, boy, if God could do it then, don't you reckon God could do it for us? And I remember praying for meetings and preaching in juvenile detention centers, different places in South Carolina. And then started preaching in some churches, got called and preached at a church in Kings Mountain. And I met Brother Galloway and his family a long time ago. I don't think he even remembered this, so I told him back last year in January. About my first meeting, it was a watch night service, and they were singing in it. And I hadn't seen them since then until last January. But nobody knew who I was. I didn't have any meetings on my calendar. I just remember praying, God, I wish you'd use me for something. God, I want to see you do something. And I never could have dreamed what God would let me do. I didn't have the accolades. I didn't have the degree like I thought you had to have. You know, I didn't know anybody. I didn't have a crowd. Just had a back room in our house where I had my Bible and read it and prayed and asked God to do something. But can I say, if I could do that, some of you young men ought to do that. Some of you young ladies could do that. We've got this thing all twisted today where we're seeking a spot on the platform. Why don't you seek a spot in the prayer closet? We're seeking our face on a flyer. Why don't you put your face in the carpet? We're wanting everybody to know our name. I want everybody to know his name. The Bible said, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Why? Because they're going to be filled. Can I say the reason you don't have is because you ain't hungry? The reason it's so dry is because we're not thirsty. I want to testify tonight, well, slow down, just say this, God's better than a dollar bill. God's better than being a star on some kind of field. And I'm not against you doing that. That's fine. God is sweeter than anything this world could give you. God is more satisfying than success down here. I mean, God is the chief executive. God is the most powerful legislator. God is the source of hope and our storehouse of strength. And we need someone to get a hold of God for this generation. It's amazing how many Christians will get active when it comes to politics and won't get active when it comes to God. And they'll get fanatical when it comes to their football team. And I'm just as bad as y'all are, but they won't get too fanatical when it comes to God. Can I say we might see something happen in our nation if you and I just get sold out and serious about seeking the face of God. I want to ask you, would you seek him tonight? Would you seek the God who created you? Would you seek the God who knew you before you ever were? Would you seek the God who formed you on purpose for a purpose? Would you seek the God who loved you when you didn't love him? Would you seek the God who knows your ins and outs and still wants to be with you forever? Would you seek the God that wants to use your life? Would you seek the God who wants to bless you beyond your wildest imagination? Would you seek that God who's called the Almighty God, that God who's better than good to us, that God who is everywhere present, that God that is holy, that God who died, but thank God after he's buried he rose again from the dead? Would you seek that God who gave you grace and mercy and love when you didn't deserve it? I'm just asking you, would you step in that realm of where God could pour it out on your life, where God could give you his power, where you can feel his hand? It doesn't matter who you are. God's not looking for perfect people. He's looking for someone who's hungry for him tonight. You might have come from a home tonight. You might ride a bus to your church. You might come from a broken family. You might not have any money. I don't care. It doesn't matter. God just wants you. If you'd sign up tonight, God could use you. If you didn't listen tonight, God could use you. Where's our generation's Moses? Where's our generation's Jacob? Where's our generation's Enoch? Where's our generation's Esther? Where's our generation's Joshua? Where's our generation's Peter? Where's our generation's Paul? Where's our generation's Samson who'll slay the Philistines? Where's our generation's young man that'll contend for the faith? Our young lady that'll launch out into the deep? Where's our generation's person that'll let their light shine before men? We've got to have one in our day. We've got to have somebody get serious, somebody surrender and say, I'll seek after God. Prospering doesn't come by being popular or even by being prosperous. Prospering comes by seeking God. I've heard about that sermon Jonathan Edwards preached, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. He preached that sermon from a manuscript, just read it word for word. He wasn't bombastic. He didn't preach like you preachers do. He just read it. And the power of God fell in such a way, church members got saved. Ones that were saved got under conviction, got right. And that great awakening began to spark and spread in New England. You ever read that sermon? But what a lot of people don't read is what happened before. For 3 days and three nights, Jonathan Edwards fasted and prayed, and he sought God. And he prayed this prayer over and over, Lord, if I give you Jonathan Edwards, would you give me New England? If I give you Jonathan Edwards, would you give me New England? If I give you Jonathan Edwards, would you give me New England? You see what happened? I'll tell you what happened. God took Jonathan Edwards and gave him New England. I wonder if you've ever prayed, God, if I gave you myself, could I have my lost brother? God, if I gave you myself, could I have my lost sister? God, if I gave you myself, could I have my city? God, if I gave you myself, could I have my mom, my dad for Jesus? God, if I gave you myself, could I have my kids? My prodigal, would you bring him home? God, if I gave you myself, could I have my church? If I gave you myself, would you give me my city, my country, my generation? Daniel didn't get 10 times better by following the crowd. He wasn't a standout because he's trying to fit in. He didn't make a difference because he wasn't different. I'll tell you why Daniel was 10 times better is because he sought God. He stood out. He was different. Can I say, why don't you be a seeker and make a difference with your life? Would you be a seeker and try to preserve righteousness in our nation? Would you be a seeker and stand in the gap tonight? Would you be a seeker and make up the hedge? Would you just be a seeker and transcend that which is usual? Would you be a seeker and stand up and stand out? Would you be a seeker and impact somebody else's life for God in eternity? Would you be a seeker and hunger for Him? Would you be a seeker and purpose in your heart? Would you be a seeker and pay that price, whatever it might be? Would you be a seeker and keep your light shining? Would you touch heaven for earth? Would you make history while everybody else wants to study it? Let me park there and say, I don't want to just study history. I'd like to make some in our generation. Would you seek Him? Seekers have been shepherds. Seekers have been fishermen. Seekers have been kings. Seekers have been prophets. Seekers have been farmers. Seekers have been normal people. Can I say our generation's seeker could be you? There's no pre-existing condition. There is no attribute. We just need someone who says, God, if you'd use me, I sure wish you'd use me. What's a seeker? It's a visionary. You see, what's a seeker? Somebody who wants to be a soldier. Who's a seeker? Someone who's passionate for God. Who's a seeker? Might be a maverick, have to stand alone. Who's a seeker? A person has one objective and one obsession and one goal and one aim. A seeker is not a casual person. A seeker is not almost in. A seeker isn't someone who's hit and miss. A seeker isn't just in whenever everybody else is in, but they won't be in regardless. Amen right there. A seeker is all in. They're consumed. They're constrained. They're confined. They're compelled to one pursuit. They count the costs and take the deal. They don't seek to understand what the world's got going on. They want to know the heart of God. A seeker is a deer after the water. I said a baby after the milk. He says, I don't want those interested in seeking worldly pleasures. I don't want those seeking things down here. I want to seek Him. I tell you what I long for. Man, if we could just get one young man in the crowd like this. Here's the problem. We look at ourselves through the lens of our ability. And because you can't do it, you think it can't be done. Why don't you quit looking at whatever it is through the lens of what you can do and start looking at whatever it is through the lens of what God can do with you? And understand, just because you can't make it happen doesn't mean God can't make it happen. Can I say God can take a stutterer and make him a preacher? God can take someone who can't even read and use him to turn a nation back to God. God can take someone who's educated in the most esteemed public institution and humble their heart, give them faith, and let them spark an awakening. Can I say it doesn't matter who you are, what walk of life you're from, God could use you if you let Him. Uzziah was 16 years old. I'd say it's about time to get started. You don't have to wait till you're older. You don't have to wait till down the road. I'm talking about today. Let me give you a couple of thoughts. Seek God soon. Seek Him soon. Seek Him early. Number two, seek God sincerely. I told you I didn't have any points, but I thought about some. Seek God seriously. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. We've got too many all night lock-ins where they play video games and stuff. We don't have enough all-night prayer meetings. Will you used to have preacher boy competitions. Now we have dunk contests at youth rallies. Hello. I was preaching for a preacher up in outside of Rockingham, North Carolina, a long time ago. And he and I were eating at a barbecue restaurant up there, and he said, I tell you, the older man, he's in heaven now. He said, I'll tell you what's wrong with your generation. And I'll be honest with you, I always get a little bit defensive when it starts off that way just because I want to say, well, let me tell you what happened. My generation is the way it is because some of y'all and that. But anyway, it sure would be good if some of the older preachers wouldn't change after 30 years, wouldn't it? But he said, let me tell you what's wrong. He said, I remember when I was your age, we'd go to meetings. He said, it wasn't anything to go to a meeting. He said, an hour before service, he said, all the men would be outside behind the church with their face in the leaves begging God to move. He said, the women would be inside the church begging God to move. He said, and we'd see kids get saved. We'd see prodigals get restored. We'd see families put together. He said, I tell you what your generation's missing. He said, you got iPhones and iPads and everything. He said, but we don't have a group of young men out in the leaves like we did in my generation. So we don't have those ladies begging God like in my generation. And can I tell you, when he said that, man, God smote my heart. Because there's some truth to it, not everywhere, but overall. It's a pretty true statement. And I can't do anything about what you do. And I can't control what other churches do. But I can control my heart toward God. And my hunger for God. And my desire for God. And I've just gone ahead and resolved. Now, I'm not perfect, and I might fail him tomorrow, and I hope I don't. But by the grace of God, I want to seek you while I can. Because I want to see God do something for the sake of your generation. Oh, I want to see God do something. You know, we're one election away and not having the freedom to do what we're doing tonight. I mean, if it had gone a different way so many years ago, we wouldn't even be here tonight, maybe. We might have been in jail by now. And yet we still casually pop our bubble gum, go to church. I mean, I'm not mad at you. I'm just saying it's time somebody gets serious about serving them. He's better than good. Young man might be here and say, I feel like God's called me to preach, but you hadn't taken the step. Would you just step out? Say, tonight I'm going to surrender. Some of you young ladies maybe got to put down whatever it is that's getting in the way and say, you know what, I'm going to pick up my walk with God again and get serious about seeking him. You've heard the old statement that was made about America's great because America's good, you know. I forget the man who made this statement, but he said one reason he said America prospered because it was, what did he say, founded by pilgrims who were seeking God. South America failed because it was founded by soldiers seeking gold. But I'm afraid our country's become what that one was. And unless we get another generation that'll seek his face, I don't know what'll be in 10 years. Tonight I'm going to pray. That's the message God put on my heart for tonight. I just want you to imagine there's a sign-up sheet on this altar. There's not one, but just imagine it. I wonder if you come write your name on that and say, Lord, if nobody else does, boy, I want to seek you for my generation. Let's bow our heads just for a moment. Lord, I pray for your touch upon this service tonight. Thank you for the liberty to preach, the young people, their good attention, these young men, young ladies, good crowd. But God, more than just a good meeting, I pray that you'd speak to a heart. Boy, just one, if just one would get a hold of this thing, I pray tonight that you'd let that happen. Maybe here tonight, and as folks have their heads bowed, maybe here tonight and say, preacher, I'm here tonight. I've not really been in church a whole lot, but I'm here tonight. And maybe you'd be honest, if I was going to be honest with you tonight, preacher, you say, if I died tonight, I don't know that I'm ready to meet God. You might be here tonight, and you're concerned about eternity. You say, Brother Cooper, I'm not sure I'm ready to meet God tonight. Would you lift up your hand and say, I want you to pray for me. Would you lift it up right now if that's you? Say, all right, I see your hand back here. Anybody else say, pray for me? You can put it back down. Anybody else say, pray for me? Up and right back down. I'm going to pray. This altar is open. If you need to come tonight, you come. If you need to be saved tonight, you come. If you're not ready to meet God, you come and let somebody help you from the Bible. Young people, why don't we get on this altar? Let's pray for our generation tonight. Let's get a hold of God for our generation. Lord, I pray you bless now in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand to our feet if you're able. She plays. Altar's open. If you want to sit in your pew, that's okay. But there's something good about kneeling at an altar. Would you step out?